Hi, Abhishek here. So, JavaScript is all about objects. I'll start with a few fundamentals. So, the first thing is the object itself. Are there any non-object things in JavaScript? And the answer is yes. There are five types actually that are not objects, and then there is the object. So the difference between these five types, number, string, boolean, undefined, null, and object, is that these are not mutable. And by not mutable, it means that you cannot change their properties. Once memory is allocated for them, that's when they're created, you can make almost no change to them. Objects are mutable. So that's the only difference. This is again a very basic thing of the object notation. So the first one, obj1, is the object in the literal notation. Second one is when we create it through the object constructor. The third one is a function. Function is also an object. This is how we retrieve a value in the object. So object, because object is a collection of the properties, so to get to those properties, we should have an expression within those big brackets. And if it's a legal JavaScript name, not a reserved word, we can use a dot notation as well. If we use a foreign loop, we can loop through all the properties in the object, and there is a built-in method called hasOnProperty that will get you to the properties of the object that are not inherited. Foreign will get you properties that are functions as well, and delete will remove a property. So the not readable part of this is from the ES5 specification, which actually tells what properties are like. So you don't need to read all that. The point is that there are several properties in the objects that we as programmers, or for the operators, they are not available. Several are such that are implemented differently across environments, across browsers. And there are some that are very useful but not a part of the standard. So what we mostly deal with is actually name data property. There are some name accessor properties also, so you can define properties that are like getters and setters. So you object.property and a function is invoked. A very special kind of object is a function. A function, as there were so many properties, internal properties. Function has internal properties that hold the function's code. The function is created with a function keyword. There was a property over there, internal property called class. So for function objects, the value of class is function. And the code may not necessarily be in JavaScript. The invocation happens with the parentheses, and whenever a function is created, the function's prototype property is set. So prototype property is different from the function's prototype. So I'll be coming to that. All objects have a prototype, prototype internal property. And the prototype we are talking about here is an externally visible property called prototype. So there is a bit of confusion in naming. I'll clarify that in further slides. There is a thing called there is a property called constructor that we have for all objects, function as well as objects. And in the special case of function objects, the constructor for the prototype of the function is the function itself. So that's what is the last line. So I'll be detailing constructors as well. This is a bit from directly copied from the spec. This is what happens when we are creating the function. So like I said, every object has an internal prototype property. That's the within brackets prototype in the third line. We have an operator, a function actually, called proto with underscores on both sides. That is available to us in Mozilla and Chrome and Node. So that's a non-standard property. That's not a part of the specification. So you cannot use it in any production code. So the point of that property is that for an object, it will give you the prototype internal properties value. You can also set the prototype internal properties value, although that is also non-standard. But the point I'm trying to make here is that the prototype linkage or internal property of any function, that capital F over there is the function I created in one of the previous ones. So that is equal to this function's prototype. So this function with a capitalized function is a built-in constructor that we that is used for creating functions. Length and prototype property you can see later. So this is again a very silly example to demonstrate that function is an object, therefore it can be treated very much like an object and passed around as function arguments. So that the example here is there is a chopper object, it has a fly property. That fly property is actually a function. So when we do a chopper.fly, it should do something to fly, and it accepts how to fly as the argument. Now how to fly is being invoked as a function, so we can pass in a function and set how the chopper should fly. So in those two things I have decided like how the flying should be done via by passing the function to new functions. These functions don't have names, they are called anonymous functions. So those functions are passed into that fly method, fly property, and there it is invoked. So that's how this thing is working. There are various ways to invoke a function. The most popular is as a method. So when it is associated as an object's property, and then you know the parenthesis operator is used, then the function is invoked. So when it is invoked this way, this inside the function is set to the object of which this function is a method. This is a variable, it's available to all functions inside the function code. So when the function is invoked as a method, this is equal to the object. When the function is not invoked as a method, the next slide, this will be the global object. Now this binding of this will happen only at the invocation time. So like the last moment, so we can switch things. This is the other thing where the function is invoked globally without an object. and in this case that this is bound to the global object. The global object comes from the environment. So if we go to the environment and try doing this, we get a rather big object. So this is the global object of my node REPL that I'm running. In browsers, this global object may be something else. So that was the thing. This is an important invocation where the function is invoked with the new operator. When the function is invoked with a new operator, it behaves as a constructor. So whatever code is there in the function, that is executed as though it was the method of a new object, and the new object is created before that invocation. So it generates a new object. That's the main point here. There is one more style of invoking functions where we call the apply method on the function itself, and we pass the object right here. We pass the objects and the parameters as arguments to apply. So we have the function defined over there, object here, and we do an apply to invoke that foo function. So
is it similar to foo of that object obj?
Right, so that's an equivalent of obj dot. And whenever we execute, invoke a function within the code, just like there is a this object, there is an arguments objects as well available. So arguments holds a list of arguments of that are passed to the function. So while declaring the function, you don't really need to be hard and fast about what is going in the parameter list, how many parameters are there. So as many parameters are passed, it will take them and assign them to this arguments object. So if you are expecting a variable number of arguments, maybe this will be useful. So the scope in JavaScript is function scope and not block scope. So block scope is in languages like C, where a variable defined within a block is available only within that block, and it is not in general visible outside the block. Here is the function. So a variable that is defined within a function is visible throughout that function but not outside. So that enables us to make use of closure. Actually, when function is defined through an expression, what it returns actually is a closure. A closure is a structure where closure is the object that holds like the environment of a function. So say if we have, let me see if I have an example. Yeah, I have an example, so I'll show it through the example. So basically the advantage of having function scope is that there is a very useful pattern that of course uses closure only. In that pattern, what we do is we return an object from the function, and that object has access to all the variables defined within that function, and only that object has access, and from outside the scope of that function you cannot access those variables. So this pattern is being used in several ways that I'll show later, and it is used in certain optimizations as well. that for that optimization I have an example, and in that example the closure thing will also come up. So this is a very simple is prime number function. So call it on a number, it will tell whether it is a prime number or not, true or false. So using this function scope thing, we are trying to create an optimization here. The optimization is that so the advantage we are getting out of all this is that if it is already calculated is prime for a certain value, then it will not calculate it again. Instead, it will keep it in a cache. So that cache is maintained within the function itself, and that cache is not visible from outside. And this code is from the previous is prime function. What we are doing additional here is that we have declared a cache, and if that cache contains that number that we have passed, then it will fetch the value right from the cache and not do all this. That's the optimization. And if it is not present, then it will do all this and add the number to the cache. So what really is the thing to be noted here is we have declared two functions here. So one is the main is prime function, and the other is prime inner function. So is prime inner function can access cache and all, but anything outside of is prime cannot access cache. That's one. Second is we are invoking is prime function immediately. So rather the function that we are trying to bind to is prime, we are invoking it immediately. That's the two parentheses over there. And by invoking this, we are actually trying to return the inner function. So it's a function that returns another function, and when we invoke is prime, we are actually invoking this one, is prime inner. Yeah, so this entire thing is called only once, cache and all is created, and every time we try to call is prime, we are actually invoking is prime inner. And because is prime inner always in future will have a link to cache, it will be able to use it, and that's the advantage of this scope and closure.
So just now we have been talking about this in the other session, that I think during the memory optimization we said a closure is optimized in the browser so that if a number is being used inside a function which accesses the closure,
right,
only those variables will be kept in memory, where the rest of them will be garbage collected.
So
like for example, if you in this particular case, num is a value that you are going to pass dynamically.
Right.
Right. But assume that the cache is accessed with a hard coded num value.
Okay.
I understand the rest of them will be garbage collected out of the dictionary.
So I'm not really sure, but I didn't really get your point. So you're saying that what rest of the values are you talking
about? So for example, if cache, let's say, has PO001 is a purchase order object, right?
Okay.
And then it has P002, which has another instance of a purchase order.
Okay.
Right? I'm just giving a JSON. Let's assume it's a JSON.
Yeah, yeah, right.
So if you had accessed cache P001 hard coded,
okay,
in the return of, let's say, is prime either,
okay,
then purchase order P002 would have been garbage collected to save memory in the browser.
So
that's what he talked about in the
okay, maybe. So I'm not aware of that optimization, if browser makes that optimization, but as far as I have understood so far, the use of scope, so I'm guessing
so
what I am saying is if we call this is prime say 10 times, then the cache will have 10 values, and it will, and those 10 values will be there and they will not be removed. That's what I am saying. You're saying in browser there is an optimization where that cache is.
I didn't say that, but he was saying.
Okay, I'm not aware of that. So, object creation happens in these two styles. So, so I changed the chapter actually. I'm going to constructors and prototypes. So, these two styles are rather, the first style is the most popular, everybody uses it. The second style is the latest standard where we pass in an object that the created object should inherit from. The third is what I'll be talking more about probably. So every object has a prototype property, and prototype is an internal property. All right, I talked about all this. We want to get the prototype. We have to have the proto object, constructor functions. Yeah. So may I use the
10 minutes, sir.
10 minutes. Yeah. So what I really wanted to demonstrate here is that if you try to create an object through this and check if it is having a prototype property, it does not have. And if you try to create a function like this, and check if the function has a prototype, it does have something. So this got me really surprised. The thing is that object obj and function f both have prototype. The prototype they have is a prototype internal property, which.
What if I put f dot prototype dot prototype?
What if you put
f dot prototype dot prototype?
So if you want to check, okay, let's check. So f dot prototype is an ordinary object, not a function object. So it does not have a prototype property by default. So objects, ordinary objects, do not have a prototype property by default. Only function objects have prototype property, but ordinary objects have prototype. So if we check this, we get something. If we check this, we get something. So prototype, this underscore underscore proto, this is the linkage that defines what object this object is going to inherit from. So it is very well known. Everybody says that in JavaScript we have only objects, we don't have classes. So for inheritance, objects have to inherit directly from objects. That's all okay. The problem is that inheritance object to object is not direct. That inheritance follows an indirection where via the constructor function. So this prototype property of the object, this one is totally non-standard, we cannot use it, and there is no way to set the object's prototype internal linkage by us. So JavaScript engines do that internally, we are not supposed to set them
unless you constructor
right. Right. So once an object is created, there is no way to set its prototype linkage or change its prototype linkage. Prototype linkages are not there. So that's the biggest point of my talk here. That's the biggest thing I discovered as learning JavaScript.
But why would I set it? Why would I?
For doing inheritance. So you have an object, animal object, you have a cat object. Animal object has certain properties and methods. You want cat to inherit them. You cannot do it directly to follow the constructor route. So how the constructor route is taken, I've taken code from object.beget that's defined in Crawford's book, that the good part. So basically, the function is that is going to be used as your object's constructor. That function, the prototype property, should be set to the parent object. So if you want an object to inherit from your parent object, you have to create a function, then set its prototype to the parent object, and then create the child. So far available to all environments, this is the only way you can do it. Yeah, that's it.
In the common use case, he asked the question why you use the common use cases, you create adjacent data structure from Ajax, right?
Okay.
And then you are trying to convert that object into, let's say, attach its prototype to a existing class so that you can directly invoke methods on that JSON data structure.
Yeah, that is fun.
That's a use case. So how do you do that here?
So I'm talking about things much basic level than that example. So I don't know how to fix it in your example. But the thing is that you want an object that inherits from some other object. Okay, this is the only way to create it. Okay, so generally when you want an object, generally you will have a constructor for it. Okay, so like CoffeeScript and all provide things like class and all. So what that class thing does is it just creates a constructor for your object, and that constructor is nothing but a function with a capital first letter. So that's by convention. So you call that constructor with a new keyword, and that's how you get a new object. And if you want that object to inherit something, before calling that constructor, you have to set the prototype property of that constructor. Now there is one more way. This is not implemented in i8, but the rest of the browsers have this object.create. Within create as a parameter, you can pass the parent object. So this is one easy way. Constructing, okay, all this I have covered. So this is a diagram from the spec. So these dotted lines are the actual prototype linkages, the underscore underscore proto underscore underscore. This is your constructor function, and this is constructor function dot prototype the object. So these are all ordinary objects, this is also an ordinary object, and this is a constructor function. Because this is a function, it will definitely have a prototype property. You have to set it to your parent object, and all your child objects can inherit from this. So another observation is that all objects, any type, will have a constructor property. Object.constructor, you check it, it will be there. But the problem is that the constructor property is mostly not useful except for the constructor property of the functions that we are going to use for creation of objects. Normally, objects' constructor property is not useful, but it is there. Can I take 5 more minutes?
Okay, but you need less time for Q&A. Is that fine?
Yeah, sure, that should be fine. So this is how objects inherit from other objects, but I have two patterns that are used in code mostly that I want to discuss, where inheritance is actually being used. They are both popular, they have pros and cons, so I'll quickly discuss them. This is my vehicle class. If I was using CoffeeScript, I would write class vehicle. Plain JavaScript, it's just function vehicle. This is the constructor function. It will set the name of the vehicle position. Okay. In the prototype inheritance pattern, what you do is you augment, you add methods to the prototype of the constructor. So when we write vehicle.prototype.move, so this move method is being added to the prototype object of vehicle constructor, and the objects created from vehicle constructor will now be able to use this move method. So This quote actually is very cleanly created when we use in class in coffee set. There is no inheritance in here. So I just had a vehicle class and then had added two methods to it, and then created a new vehicle object called myCars, called the methods, and here I called the position property directly. That's a property of the object myCar. So we can do property lookups. We need them sometimes. When we have to create a child object, what we do is we create a new constructor. So this is my child class two wheeler. This is where I am specifying that two wheeler is inheriting from vehicle, and then after that adding methods to it. So my two wheeler is Pulsar. It is moving, giving position. It can move is there in vehicle, and it can give you the internal properties as well. Not internal properties per se, properties of the class as well. The good thing here is that this is pretty popular and usable and readable. The problem is that there is no way to hide data. So whatever properties your objects Pulsar and myCar have, they are visible everywhere. The other pattern that is used is called functional inheritance pattern. The advantage is that we get data ID, and readability is, I don't know, subjective. So not able to. So basically here what we are doing is we are creating an object within a function. So we are not going to use the new operator here. We are not using that constructor pattern at all. So we are just defining a function called vehicle, and we are creating the vehicle object within that function and returning that object. So whenever we call that vehicle function, invoke that function, it gives an object. That's pretty.
That's not prototype variables.
Here this itself is looks like a class. It's not exactly a class, so it doesn't match a class in many properties. So that's why it's functional in nature. The advantage we get here is that if we try to call my car dot position, we cannot get it because position variable has function scope. You cannot use it outside.
The question was my car dot prototype. Will it return a variable because it doesn't use view?
No. My car dot prototype will not have anything. It will be undefined.
But if you had done the earlier one, my car dot prototype would have returned your
vehicle. Right. And for having inheritance, what we do is we define another function which looks like a class, create the original parent class object, and then add methods to that object itself. So this looks pretty simple and direct. The advantage we get is that we have data hiding, and the disadvantage is that that it doesn't look and feel like a class. So if you are if you want things to behave like more like class, the prototype inheritance pattern is better. Done.
Wait, no. Like one question, I guess.
Right.
Any, like one question, final question?
Say I followed the prototype of inheritance pattern, and I inherited, say, class A inherits B and B inherits C. So I have a method on C which is coming from A. So is there any way I could find that is coming from A? Like, how do I find from where this method is?
So exactly which... okay, where is that method exactly coming from? Yeah, there is no direct method, but you know, you can add some has on property and all is there. So you can keep subtracting, and there are methods to do it. There is no single operator for it. You can check whether it is coming from it by using instance of operator, but which one it is coming from, that's not direct.
All right. Let's thank the speaker.